Good morning, students. Today's class we will see about the fetal skull and maternal pelvis. Fetal skull. Fetal skull is to be some extent compressible and made mainly of thin pliable tabula, that is flat bones forming the vault. It is anchored to the rigid and incompressible bones at the base of the skull. This is the picture of a fetal skull. They have a parietal bone, posterior fornella, occipital bone, mastoid fornell, anterior fornell, xiphoid fornell, frontal bone and temporal bone. Areas of the skull. The skull arbitrarily divide into several zones of obstetrical importance. The three one is the important are vertex, brow and face. Vertex is the quadrangular area bounded anteriorly by the brachma, that is the anterior fornella, and coronal sutures behind the lambda and lambert sutures, and laterally by the lines passing through the parietal eminence. Brow. It is an area bounded to one side of the anterior fornella and coronal sutures, and on either side by the root of the nose and the supraorbital ridges on either side. Face. It is an area bounded on one side of the root of the nose and supraorbital ridges, and on the other by the junction of the floor of the mouth with the neck. So these are the bones of the neonatal skull. Sinciput is the area lying in the front of the anterior fornella, corresponds to the area of brow, and the occiput is limited to the occipital bone. Flat bones of the vault are united together by non-ossified membranes attached to the margins of the bone. These are called sutures and fornella. Of many sutures and fornella, the following are of the obstetric significance. Sutures. Sagittal suture or longitudinal suture lies between two parietal bones. Coronal sutures run between the parietal and frontal bones on the either side. Frontal suture lies between two frontal bones. Lambert sutures separate the occipital bone and two parietal bones. So these are the sagittal suture, Lambert sutures, coronal sutures and metopic sutures. So anterior fornella and the front view, and this is the lateral view. Importance of the sutures. It permits the gliding movement of the one bone over the other during the molding of the head. The phenomena of significance while the head passes through the pelvis during labor. Digital palpation of sagittal sutures during internal examination in labor gives an idea of manner of engagement of the head, degree of internal rotation of the head and degree of molding of the head. Fornellas. While gap in the suture line is called as a fornella, of many fornella, that are, there are six in number, two are of obstetric importance. First one is anterior fornella brachma, and second one is posterior fornella or lambda. Anterior fornella, it is formed by joining of four sutures in the midplane. The sutures are anterior fornella, anteriorly fornell, posteriorly sagittal, and either side coronal. The shape is like a diamond, and its anteroposterior and transverse diameters measured approximately 3 cm each. The floor is formed by a membrane and becomes ossified 18 months after birth. If it becomes pathological, if it fails to ossify even after 24 months. The importance of anterior fornella. Its palpation through internal examination denotes the degree of flexion of the head. It facilitates molding of the head. As it remains membranous long after birth, it helps accommodating the marked brain cloth. The brain becomes most double in size during the first year of life. Palpation of floor reflects intracranial status, depression in dehydration, elevated in rise intracranial tension. Collection of blood and oxygen transfusion on rare occasion can be performed through via superior longitudinal sinus. Cerebrospinus can be drawn, although rarely, through the angle of anterior fornella from the lateral ventricle. Posterior fornella. It is formed by junction of three suture lines, where the sutures anteriorly, Lambert suture on the either side. It is a triangular in shape and measures 1.5 into 1.5 cm. Its floor is membranous but become bony at term. Thus, truly its nomenclature as fornella is a misnomer. It denotes the position of the head in relation to the maternal pelvis. sagittal fornella. It is inconsistent in its presence when it is present situated on the sagittal suture on the junction of anterior 2/3 and posterior 1/3. It has got no clinical importance. Diameters of the fetal skull. The engaging diameter of fetal skull depend on degree of flexion present. First one is biparietal diameter or 9.5 cm. It extends between two parietal eminence. Whatever may be the position of the head, this diameter nearly always engage. Subparietal diameter. It extends from a pinpoint from a point placed below the one parietal eminence to the point placed above the other parietal eminence to the opposite side. Bitemporal diameter. Distance between anterior inferior ends of the coronal suture. Bimastoid diameter. It is the distance between tips of the mastoid process. The diameter is incompressible and it is impossible to reduce the length of bimastoid diameter by obstetric operation. So these are the diameters of the fetal skull. Circumference. Circumference of the plane of the diameter of engagement differs according to the attitude of the head. Molding. It is an alteration of the shape of the forthcoming head while passing through the resistant birth passage during labor. Therefore, however, very little alteration in size of the head as volume of the content inside the skull is incompressible, although small amount of cerebrospinal fluid and blood escape out the process. During the normal delivery, an alteration of 4 mm in the skull diameter commonly occurs. Mechanism of mold. The compression of the engaging diameter of the head with corresponds to the elongation of the diameter at the right angle to it. Thus, in a well-flexed head of anterior vertex presentation, the engaging suboccipital brachmatic diameter is compressed with the elongation of the head. In Mendo, vertical diameter which is at right angle to suboccipital brachmatic. During the process, the parietal bonds tend to overlap the adjacent bonds, namely occipital bond behind, the frontal bonds in front and temporal bonds at the side. In forced vertex position, the right parietal bond tend to override the left or one and it becomes reverse in the second vertex position. Molding disappears within few hours after birth. Grading. Grading of molding. Grade 1. The bonds touching but not overlapping. Grade 2. Overlapping but easily separated. Grade 3. Fixed overlapping. The possible presenting diameters of an average term fetal skull. Caput succedaneum. It is the formation of swelling due to stagnation of fluid in the layers of scalp beneath the griddle of contact. The griddle of contact is either bony or dilating cervix or vulval ring. The swelling is diffuse, boggy and is not limited to the suture line. It may be confused with cephalhematoma. It disappears spontaneously within 24 hours after birth. Mechanism of formation. While the head descends to press over the dilating cervix or vulval ring, the overlying scalp is free from pressure, but the tissues in contact with the full circumference of the griddle of contact is compressed. This interferes the venous return and lymphatic drainage from unsupported area of scalp, that is stagnation of fluid and appearance of swelling in the scalp. Caput usually occurs after the rupture of membrane. Importance. It signifies the static position of the head for a long period of time. Location of caput gives an idea about the position of head occupied in the pelvis and degree of flexion achieved. In left position, the caput placed in the right parietal bond and the right position left parietal bond. With increasing flexion, caput is placed more posteriorly. This is a picture of a caput succedaneum. So this is how it looks baby after delivery. Pelvis. From the obstetrical standpoint, it is useful to consider the bony pelvis as a whole rather than separately. For descriptive purpose, an articulated pelvis is comprised of four bones, two innominate bones, sacrum and coccyx. These are united together by four joints, two sacroiliac joints, sacrococcygeal joints and symphysis pubis. This is a picture of a female pelvis as well as the male pelvis. You can notice the shape of the inlet. This is a picture of a pelvis. Pelvis is anatomically divided into a first pelvis and trope pelvis. The boundaries line between the brim of the pelvis. The bony landmark of the brim of the pelvis from anterior to posterior on each side are upper border of symphysis pubis, pubic crust, pubic tubercle, pectineal line, iliopectineal, iliopubic eminence, iliopectineal line, sacroiliac articulation, anterior border of the anal sacrum and sacral promontory. False pelvis. False pelvis is formed by iliac portions of the innominate bones and is limited above the iliac crust. It has got little obstetric significance except that its measurements can to certain extent predict the size and configuration of the pelvis. Its only obstetric function is to support the enlarged uterus during pregnancy. Its boundaries are posteriorly the lumbar vertebra, laterally the iliac fossa and anteriorly the anterior abdominal wall. True pelvis. This is the part of pelvis is chiefly concerned with obstetricians as it forms the canal through which the fetus has to pass. It is a shallow infant formed by symphysis pubis and measures 4 cm and deep posteriorly formed by sacrum and coccyx and measures 11.5 cm. For descriptive purpose, it is divided into inlet, cavity and outlet. The pelvic measurements given in the text are average when they measured radiologically and vary within limited degree in different countries. The conversion of centimeters into inches is approximate. So the red in color, that brown in color shows the false pelvis and the second picture, the brown in color shows the true pelvis. Inlet. As the inlet is the brim of the pelvis, the circumference of inlet is formed by bony landmarks mentioned previously. Shape. It is almost round, that means gynecoid, with the anteroposterior diameter being the shortest. Other different shapes of inlet are anthropoid, android and platyploid. The plane. It is the imaginary flat surface bounded by the bony points mentioned as those of the brim. It is not strictly a mathematical plane and this is therefore often referred to as superior state. Inclination. In erect posture, the pelvis is tilted forward. As such, the plane of the inlet makes an angle of about 55 degrees with the horizontal and is called angle of inclination. Another way of measuring the inclination radiographically is to take an angle between plane of the inlet and front of the body and fifth lumbar vertebra. The angle is normally about 135 degrees. This is the inlet view. This is an outlet. Second one is the outlet view. The down picture shows the anteroposterior view and the lateral view. When the angle of inclination is increased due to sacralization of fifth lumbar vertebra, it is called high inclination. High inclination has got obstetric significance. First, it delays engagement because uterine axis fails to coincide with that of inlet. It favors occipital posterior position. There is a difficulty in descent of head due to long birth canal and flat sacrum interfering with internal rotation. The angle of inclination may be lessened in case of lumbarization of first piece of sacral vertebra and that is called as low inclination. It has got no obstetric significance. It actually facilitates early engagement. Sacral angle. It is the angle formed by true conjugate with the first two pieces of the sacrum. Normally, it is a greater than 90 degree. A greater angle of lesser degrees is the funneling of the pelvis. Axis. It is the mid-perpendicular line drawn to the plane of the inlet. Its direction is downward and backward. When extended, the line passes through the umbilicus to the coccyx. It is important that uterine axis should coincide with the axis of inlet so that the force of uterine contraction will be spread in the right direction to force the fetus to pass through the brim. Diameters. The measurements of the diameters are all approximate and minor variation in the rule rather than the exception. Anteroposterior diameter, that is true conjugate, otherwise known as anatomical conjugate or conjugate beta. It is the distance between the midpoint of sacral promontory to the inner margin of upper border of symphysis pubis. It measures 11 cm. It is not the shortest diameter of inlet and anteroposterior plane. In practice, true conjugate cannot be estimated directly. However, its measurement is inferred by subtracting 1.2 cm from diagonal conjugate, thus allowing for the inclination, thickness and height of the symphysis pubis. Obstetric conjugate. So the distance between the midpoint of the sacral promontory to the prominent bony projection in the midline of inner surface of the symphysis pubis. The point is somewhat below the upper border. It is the shortest anteroposterior diameter in the anteroposterior plane of the inlet. It measures 10 cm. It cannot be clinically estimated, but it is to be inferred from diagonal conjugate, that is 1.5 to 2 cm, to be detected or by lateral radiopelvimetry. Diagonal conjugate. This is the distance between lower border of symphysis pubis to the midpoint of the sacral promontory. It measures nearly 12 cm. It is measured clinically during pelvic assessment in late pregnancy or in labor. Obstetric conjugate computed by subtracting 1.5 to 2 cm from the diagonal conjugate depending upon the height, thickness, inclination of the symphysis pubis. Internal figures are removed and distance between marking and the tip of the middle finger gives the measurement of the diagonal conjugate. For practical purpose, if the middle finger fails to reach the promontory or touches it with difficulty, it is likely to that conjugate is adequate for average size head to pass through. So the red in picture shows the obstetrical conjugate and the blue in line shows the diagonal conjugate. Transverse diameter. It is the distance between two farthest points on the pelvic brim over the iliopectineal lines. It measures 13 cm. The diameter lies slightly closer to the sacral promontory and divides the brim into anterior and posterior segment. The head negotiates the brim through a diameter called available or obstetrical transverse. This is described as a diameter which bisects the anteroposterior diameter in the midpoint, thus obstetrical transverse either equal or less than the anatomical transverse. Oblique diameters. There are two oblique diameters, right and left. Each of one extends from one sacroiliac joint to the opposite iliopubic eminence and measures 12 cm. Right or left denotes the sacroiliac joint from which it starts. Sacrocotyloid, that is 9.5 cm. It is the distance between midpoint of the sacral promontory to the iliopubic eminence. It represents the space occupied by the bipartite diameter of the head while negotiating the brim in flat pelvis. Cavity. Cavity is the segment of pelvis bounded above by the inlet and below by the plane of the least pelvic dimensions. Shape is almost round. Plane. The plane extends from the midpoint of posterior surface of symphysis pubis to the junction of second and third sacral vertebra. It is called plane of greatest pelvic dimensions. It is the most roomy plane of the pelvis and it is almost round in shape. Axis. The mid-perpendicular line drawn to the plane of cavity. Its direction is almost downward. Diameters. Anteroposterior. It measures from the midpoint or the posterior surface of the symphysis pubis to the junction of the second and third sacral vertebrae. Transverse. That is 12 cm. It cannot be precisely measured as the points lie over the soft tissues covering the sacro-sciatic notches and obliterate foramina. Outlet. Obstetrical outlet. It is a segment of pelvis bounded above the plane of least pelvic dimensions and below by anatomical outlet. The anterior wall is deficient at the pubic arch. It is lateral wall also formed by ischial bonds and posterior wall by including wall of the coccyx. Shape. It is anteroposteriorly oval in shape. The plane. The plane is otherwise known as plane of least pelvic dimensions or narrow pelvic plane. The plane extends from the lower border of symphysis pubis to the tip of the ischial spines and posteriorly to meet the tip of the fifth sacral vertebra. Diameters. Transverse otherwise known as bispinous diameter is a distance between tip of two ischial spines, anteroposterior 11 cm. It extends from inferior border of symphysis pubis to the tip of the sacrum, posterior lateral 5 cm. Distance between tip of the sacrum and the midpoint of bispinous diameter. Axis. It represented by the line joining the center of the plane with the sacral promontory. Its direction is almost vertical. Anatomical outlet. It is otherwise known as the bony outlet. It is the bounded in front by the lower border of symphysis pubis, laterally by the ischiopubic rami, ischial tuberosity and sacrotuberous ligament and posteriorly by tip of coccyx. Thus, it consists of two triangular planes with a common base formed by line joining the ischial tuberosities. The apex of the anterior triangle is formed by inferior border of the pubic arch and that of the posterior triangle by tip of the coccyx. shape. It is diamond in shape, plain. It is formed by a line joining the lower border of symphysis pubis to the tip of the coccyx. It forms an angulation of 10 degree with the horizontal axis. It is the mid perpendicular line turned to the plane of the outlet. The direction is downward and forward. Diameters. Antero posterior. It extends from lower border of the symphysis pubis to the tip of the coccyx. It measures 13 cm or with the coccyx pushed back and head when passing through the introitus in the second stage of labor. Transverse, otherwise known as intertuberous. It measures between the inner border of the ischial tuberosities. Posterior skeletal diameter. It is the anteroposterior distance between sacrococcygeal joint and midpoint of the transverse diameter of outlet. It is clinically measured by the distance between the sacrococcygeal joint and the anterior margin of the anus. Suprapubic angle. It is the form by approximation of two descending pubic rami. Normal pelvis, it measures 85 degree. Pubic arch. Arch formed by descending rami of both the sides of obstetric importance. Normally, it measures 6 cm in between the pubic rami at the level of 2 cm below the apex of the pubic arch. Clinically, it is assessed by placing 3 fingers side by side. Mid pelvis. Mid pelvis is a segment of pelvis bounded above by the plane of greatest pelvic dimensions and below by the plane known as mid pelvic plane. Mid pelvic plane extends from the lower margin of the symphysis pubis to the level of ischial spines to meet either the junction of S4 and S5 or tip of the sacrum depending upon the configuration of the sacrum. If the plane meets the tip of the fifth sacrum, it coincides with the plane of least pelvic dimensions. If the plane meets the junction of S4 and S5, the plane becomes wedged posteriorly. Diameters, transverse diameter, that is bispinous diameter, 10.5, which measures between two ischial spines. Anteroposterior diameter, it extends from lower border of symphysis pubis to the point of sacrum which have mid pelvic plane meets. And posterior skeletal diameter, it extends from midpoint of bispinous diameter to the point of sacrum at which the mid pelvic plane meets. Pelvic axis, anatomical or curve of Caras. Anatomical pelvic axis is formed by joining axes of inlet, cavity and outlet. It is uniformly curved with convexity and fitting of the concavity of the sacrum. Obstetrical axis. It is through the axis the fetus negotiates the pelvis. It is not uniformly curved. Its direction is first downward and backward up to the level of ischial spine, then directly, abruptly back forward. Pelvic joints. So symphysis pubis. It is a secondary fibrocartilageous joint. It has have no capsule and no synovial cavity. The articular surface are covered with hyaline cartilage. Due to softening of the ligaments during pregnancy, there is a considerable amount of misgliding movement. Sacroiliac articulation. It is a synovial joint and its articulation between the articular surface of the ilium and sacrum. The articulating surfaces are not alike. It has got capsule and a synovial cavity. Engagement to diagnosis. It is better to palpate gently with two hands facing down over the abdomen rather than prone abdomen with the polygrip, which not with a non-experienced hands is painful. Coccygeal joint. It's a synovial hinge joint. It allows both flexion and extension. Extension increases the anteroposterior diameter of the outlet. These are the differences between gynecoid, anthropoid, android, and platyploid pelvises. These are the diameters of comparisons of our brim, cavity and outlet. Thank you for listening to me.